some standard information variant descriptors, which are, for example, scale invariant HDS or
shot.
Or shot. Here we use shot. Some histogram of normals. So it is a very, very important point. If the shapes are non-isometric or noisy, then using a good descriptor that will correspond with corresponding points is a big issue. So here actually where learning should be used, in my opinion. Okay, but again, see that the problem, the solution is just one of the possible solutions. It will in general depend on how you initialize it. Okay, so again, this is how the convergence looks like. Here we have correspondence and basically two segmentations, right? The model shape and the tree shape. So basically this is represented by these three different colors. Again, no guarantee of global convergence, but overall it behaves nicely. Just a few examples. So here we have a puzzle of four pieces, and we try to assemble them with dog. In this case, all the data are synthetic, so basically they are cut from dog shape from the Tosca dataset. The data, the corresponding prop functions we use are shot descriptors. This is how the segmentation looks like, and this is how the correspondence looks like. Very good correspondence. This is another example. Here we have clutter, so we have some overlap between these parts, and still the method works very nicely. And this is the correspondence that we get. And another example here, we have also clutter and extra parts, so somebody threw in the part of the cat. This has nothing to do with the human shape, and basically it is discarded. There is no part of the cat. And again, this is correspondence. And finally, some results. So this is Orr that scanned himself. So you can see, well, Orr is not here, but you could probably recognize his face from this 3D scan. So this is a case of non-isometric shape, and still it works quite nicely. Okay, so now to the even more difficult problem of non-rigid clutter. So the kind of problem we want to solve is this. We are given a shape, let's say a cat, and we have a very cluttered scene that contains a lot of objects. It also contains a cat, a deformed version of the cat, with missing parts, with occlusions, and a lot of background stuff here that has nothing to do with the cat. Basically, we want to find the correspondence between these two objects. So think of robotics applications. You scan a room, I see here a lot of chairs, tables, people. I want to find, let's say, Ronnie from a three-dimensional model of him that I have. Okay? So that's exactly the same situation. And of course, everything is deformable. So here, the same principle that we've seen before works. Basically, if you look at the eigenfunctions of the full shape, the cluttered scene, and the part of the shape that is unknown a priori, right? Basically, I want to recover this part, right? That will correspond. You will see that the Laplacian eigenfunctions will have the same structure, just as different positions. Okay, so this will be, let's say, if this is phi j, this will be phi, psi I1, and this will be psi I2. So the ratio between this I2 and I1 indices, the position in the spectrum, will depend on the ratio of the areas of the full shape and the quadrant scene. Okay, so this is how it looks like, the structure of the matrices, and there are the C transpose C. So here you can see actually the missing rank. You see a lot of zero columns and rows in this matrix. If you look at C transpose C, you will see that those have a sparse diagonal. Okay, and basically this is what we use as a penalty in this case. We also estimate the angle of this line. So we actually, because here it's not very reliably estimated, you see that slanted diagonal structure is pretty loose here. We include it as an optimization variable into the optimization problem. So we allow to search for the slant. Okay, and what is also important here is a good descriptor. So here we use the learned descriptor and some initial assignment problem that matched a few points in the scene. Very noisily, very roughly, it was something like 10 or 20 points, everything done automatically, so no handcrafting, no hand intervention. But basically it is much more difficult problem than before. Here we have something like 10% of overlap in the query and the scene. And this is how the correspondence that we get looks like. You can see that it's pretty decent, impressive correspondence. Here's another example. Another example. Okay. How much time do I have?
Probably 7 minutes. Something.
Okay, I think that will be enough to talk about the bonus track. Basically, how to do everything in the spectral domain. So let's again look at the results that we had so far. So we had a full shape, partial shape, the functional correspondence between them, right, that was represented in the respective basis. And basically what we had, basically the main result was this slanted diagonal structure. If I formulate it in terms of inner products, it's the following thing. If I take the eigenvector of the full shape, psi and j, if I take the ith eigenvector of the partial shape and apply it with the functional correspondence, and I look at the inner product on the full shape, but basically the corresponding part, right? I want to see a slanted diagonal structure. So I can write this delta I pi j, where pi is reordering, basically. You think of it as a permutation, where the reordering depends on the ratio of the areas of these two circles. Okay? Basically, that's a way of writing that slanted diagonal metric C. And basically, we can write it, in fact, we can write it as an inner product of the full shape, but now weighted by the, basically by this indicator function. Okay? So indicator function of this part that we don't know a priori. And the optimization was with respect to this unknown part and the functional correspondence that we represented as a matrix C. Okay? And this is complicated. Basically, you have an explicit spatial model of V, or V of the part, which requires, first of all, alternating minimization with respect to C and V. And also, the complexity here is order of n, number of points in the shape. So again, if the shape is large, if you have a huge scene with thousands or millions of points, it will take you forever. It will not work. In practice, it works maybe up to 10,000 points. Otherwise, it becomes very slow. So the alternative is actually exactly the as you said. Basically, we want to change the basis. Let's look at a new basis on the full shape. Let's call it psi cap. Such that, basically, we want to go back to our nice diagonal structure that we had before. Okay? So basically, in a way, we want to rotate the slanted diagonal into a normal diagonal. So basically, we want the inner products between the new basis functions, psi hat j, and the correspondence of the partial functions, phi I under the functional correspondence operator, inner product now taken on the full shape, to be equal to delta I j. Okay?
So you can see... You freeze phi I?
I change only one of the bases. You can change both. Basically, in this case, it's matching of part to full. If you want to match two parts in both shapes, you will need to change both. It's just to make it simpler. Okay? So you see, because of this constraint, basically what happens, well, we represent, as in our joint emulation paper, these new basis functions as linear combinations of the rotation
identity. You mean psi hat there?
Right. Yeah, of course, psi. Sorry. Okay, so basically we represent them as linear combination coefficients. Okay, so basically these coefficients Q. And because of these because of this orthogonality constraint, what happens is that the new basis functions are localized. You see them here. You can immediately see why, right? Because the support of t phi I on n will be limited to this overlapping part, right? It will be zero outside. Basically, if I want orthonormal basis, basically if I want orthonormality with respect to the new basis functions, basically the new basis functions must vanish outside of that support as well.
Assuming you know the support.
Well, I don't need to know it. It will happen automatically. Yeah. Right? So I don't, basically the bottom line, the inner product here is on the shape n, full shape. I don't have any indicator function anymore. Basically my optimization variables are these matrix q. Basically I have a matrix of size k by k, so the complexity here is k squared instead of n. Okay? So I don't have any spatial model of the part. So if you look at it slightly different way, basically this is our functional correspondence equation, right? Basically, what is written here is we know basically how the eigenfunctions of the two bases relate to each other. Basically, they can relate up to sine, right? And change of order. So that's exactly the matrix pi, you can call it in quotation marks, partial sine permutation. So it's not square matrix, it's not real permutation matrix, it has columns of zeros.
You pushed the fact that you had a slanted diagonal to the fact that now if the eigenfunctions or the functions on the manifold are not good for this alignment, you will have a lot of sparse region in your diagonal.
You will have a block of zeros. I will show you immediately how it looks like. Okay. Of course. So basically what happens here is that basically this matrix is rank deficient. So if you write it as a permutation matrix of size k by k, it will have just columns of zeros. So we don't need even to consider them, right? Basically that's why I write it as a matrix of size k by r. R relates to k by the ratio of the areas. So So basically, I take k eigenvectors, I produce from them r corresponding eigenvectors, right? Okay. So basically, we relax this matrix to be an orthogonal matrix. Now it's a non-square orthogonal matrix. It's orthoprojection projection k by r, and we solve basically this problem, like we did in joint lemmatization. That's exactly joint lemmatization problem with non-square matrix. So basically, we want the resulting basis to be approximately an eigenbasis, so it must be smooth. We have here the Dirichlet energy. This is the data term. Now only for basically it's only for r first real coefficients, only for only partial shape, and orthogonality constraint on the matrix Q. Okay? Here we use robust norm to be insensitive to outliers. It requires solving this problem with optimization techniques on the Stifel manifold that can handle non-smooth cost function. We use our method, the manifold ADMM, that appeared actually this year at ECCB. So it's not only similar to joint lemmatization, that's exactly joint lemmatization. And you can interpret it as non-rigid alignment of eigenfunctions. So take just as an example, this k to be equal to n. Basically, what you see here is just change of the basis. Basically, you have a point cloud in k dimensions that you compose from basically from n Laplacian eigenvectors. It spans all the space of functions, so you can compose anything. The smoothness is what makes it behave in a certain way. And this is the data fitting term.
So Michael, except for the fitting term, isn't it CPD?
Why is it CPD?
You have the coherence term, which is your first
but
term.
But there is no orthogonality.
Well, orthogonality is an additional constraint.
So this is what Emanuele does. You do alignment with CPD.
So if you put Kullback-Leibler divergence instead of this L2-1?
Yes, probably should work at all. So just to say a few words about this interpretation of non-rigid alignment. So you can think of it as an alignment in the space of eigenfunctions. So basically, take a shape, right? Embed each point with the first k eigenfunctions, the values of the first k eigenfunctions in that point. So basically, it's a Laplacian eigenmap. Okay. Here I show the embedding with the first two Laplacian eigenfunctions, phi2 and phi3. Okay. And for the red part, c2 and p3, and c3, right? So this is how the eigenvectors, the original eigenvectors, look like. They are not well aligned. Okay. Now, this way, this is what happens when we use the modified basis, the rotated basis. Okay, you see that? The two eigenmaps are now aligned. This was the slanted diagonal matrix before. Now it becomes a diagonal matrix, of course, with missing rank. When you want to see zeros here, there are no zeros. Okay, that's it. There are, of course, no miracles. You have a lot of zeros here.
So the question is, can you play with phi so that you will have the largest support that you can think of?
Why do you need the largest? You want the support that that corresponds to exactly this part, right? You want the same area. So you can see actually that this area, let's first see how the alignment works. So this is the optimization process that aligns the basis vectors. Again, it's a projection of something k-dimensional to just two dimensions. So imagine the same thing happening in 20 dimensions. And this is how it looks like. So basically what I show here is the correspondence of the constant function on the partial shape. And you can see that it becomes exactly the indicator, or approximately the indicator, of the corresponding part of the function.
Okay. It's a band limited approximation of the indicator.
Of course, it's band limited, so that's why it was smooth, and you also have the Gibbs phenomenon, the oscillations.
But you put in the indicator function in the...
There is no indicator function whatsoever.
Optimization?
No. Where do you see the future? No.
Not in this problem.
Or this is the only optimization variable here is Q. Well, the data remains the same, it's discrete. Where do you see any indicator?
It's fully spectral.
Yeah,
there is
totally in the spectral domain. It's K by K matrix. That's all. That's your only variable here. We don't have the part V that we had to optimize for previously, alternating between the correspondence, the K by K matrix, and the V by one vector of the basically the indicator part.
Can you put one slide?
Well, the inner product is on the entire n. Before we had an inner product on the subset of L. That was the sorry?
It's an inner product.
It's an inner product of the full shape. But here it was restricted to the corresponding part, right? That was the first parameter function.
This is
here
the function
we don't
v.
Have it anymore.
This
we
is
don't.
The function v that is your unknown.
Yep. So here it was unknown. We didn't know it in advance. Here we don't need it. We get this localization automatically. So we don't have explicit model of spatial model of.
But you use the function not explicitly.
So the functional map, you can think of this cube as a functional map.
So the functional map is between full shapes, but the basis is selected in such a way that it is localized only to corresponding parts. So in this case, only one part will be localized. If you put another matrix P to the second term, to the phi matrix, then on both sides you will have localization.
What if you force the matching to create a support that is connected, well-behaved, smooth in some sense?
No, and this is one of the, let's say, mysteries here. If you look at it, so this is something I admittedly I don't understand. So you see here, basically, the dark red represents the common part. Okay? So you can see that basically it's a single connected component, and the non-overlapping parts, these pink, are two separate components. So this is how it looks like here. And you can see that they became a connected component and the red became disconnected. So this is...
Is it because you relied on the low frequencies of the Laplacian?
No, I think because basically this orthogonal matrix also does projection. So it's not only rotation. If it was only rotation, it would be impossible. Because in the eigenvectors are smooth, so they preserve connectedness in some way. Because here we also project.
So it has to do with the fact that you just throw away high frequencies.
So it's not it happened to be high frequencies, but what is important is that basically you project. It's not only rotation.
But this visualization is also a projection. It's a three-dimensional visualization. What
it,
maybe
it happens in higher dimensions.
How do you know? Maybe the topology is preserved.
Yeah,
okay.
So it happens also in higher dimensions. So this strange thing apparently happens in high frequencies, but basically because it's projection from k dimensions to r dimensions. And in this example, for example, r will be about half of k. So you can just fold things on.
What is the expression for v in your final expression?
There is no v here.
No, but it's hidden. But it's there.
It has to be,
right? This expression, what is v?
You can take a constant?
You can
take it like this. So take a constant function here and just map it to this part. And you will have a v. So that's exactly what I showed.
So can you describe this as an equation of multiplication of matrices?
So you can actually introduce a penalty on that. We try to do it first. We've seen that it doesn't really happen. So basically, it doesn't really help. We try to use this Mumford-Sharp functional on the image.
Psi times C or something.
Well, basically t of constant function on the part. It didn't really change anything. So probably it was superfluous. But there is a potential to regularize it.
The problem with this regularization is that you have a band-limited approximation of this indicator function. So you will have ringings and blurred edges anyway, regardless how you...
I would say the bigger problem, though, basically if you want to use regularization in the spatial domain, you need to do synthesis. So here we work with spectral coefficients, it's just k-squared variables. If you synthesize it, you don't have n variables. So basically you killed the efficiency that was the main point of doing everything in the spectral domain. If you could do somehow, basically, if you could say that I want sharpness in the spectral, in the spatial domain, how it is manifested in the frequency domain, maybe there could be some result. I guess there are small results in
the... How many eigenfunctions are you using here?
Sorry?
How many eigenfunctions are you using?
20, 30, something like this.
I see. This is R.
This is
a small number.
Yes.
And K.
Well, R and K, they relate by this ratio of k. So we actually, in our PAPI paper that we did for alignment of general graphs, we actually used this kind of formulation, but there we took K that was sufficiently large. So we indeed observed that basically for non-isometric partial correspondence, we could use basically this ortho projection, but we didn't have a clear idea how to choose that key. We saw that if you select it too small, it's bad. If it's too large, it's bad. Here we have a magic recipe that tells you that should be exactly the value of key, because it comes from this magic of ratio of areas that have to do with Weyl's law. So here, think finally you have an understanding how it should be, or how the parameters should be selected. Okay, so some few examples with even smaller parts. So this is what happens to the correspondence in the new basis. Some evaluation, so this is again the track, so you use all the other methods pretty significantly. And this is basically the plot that shows the purpose of all this exercise. So we show the complexity of the optimization versus the size of the chain. So you can see that it goes linearly in the previous approach in partial functional.
Given the Laplacian.
Of course, the eigenvectors are bigger. Otherwise, it's another order of n squared.
Okay. Y squared?
That's order n. R times n.
K times
n. Is it a sparse matrix? Yep. What's the complexity of computing first order one of eigenvectors of? I think it's n
computing
squared.
Each eigenvector will be some big constant times n.
I think it's n squared.
Our method?
The dense matrix will be n cubed.
But it's a sparse matrix, so if with a sparse matrix it costs you n to multiply each time a matrix by a vector, and you do a finite number of iterations that doesn't depend on n.